Behind the mysterious incident that still haunts one of America's most prestigious universities. Stanford University nurtures some of the brightest young minds in the world, but there's a dark secret buried beneath its pristine campus. The mysterious demise of Jane Stanford, the school's co-founder, still casts a long shadow. For about a century, her death was mostly forgotten, until modern journalists delved into Jane's tragic life. Their research uncovered more about the bizarre way Jane died and who may have been behind it.
Before we begin, make sure to smash that like button, subscribe to our channel, and click the notification bell for more amazing videos.
During Jane's final years, she was already living a lonely existence. Her husband, Leland, had been dead for a decade, and she resided in their mansion with only her team of servants to keep her company. On January 14, 1905, Jane took a drink of Poland spring water and knew something was immediately wrong. Jane called out for one of her maids. "Come and see what's the matter with the Poland water," she said. "I drank some and it nearly choked me. It burned me so that I ran my fingers down my throat and threw it all up." One of the housekeepers also tasted the beverage and agreed it was bitter. Staff took the remaining water to Wackerly's drugstore, where a chemist tested the liquid. To everyone's horror, someone had slipped a massive dose of strychnine in the bottle. This colorless powder was used for killing pests by absorbing into their mucous membranes, and it has the same effect on people. Jane was terrified of the poisoning attempt and decided to take a last-minute vacation to Hawaii to escape the danger and relax after such a traumatizing incident. Newspapers started reporting the story while Jane was unreachable in Hawaii. In her absence, Stanford president Dr. David Starr Jordan spoke for her. The fact is that Mrs. Stanford was threatened with pneumonia, and her physician advised a warmer climate than San Francisco, Jordan said. It was for this reason alone that she started on her trip. This wasn't all the president had to say about his boss's trip. She did, however, tell me a month ago she'd been served with a bottle of mineral water, which had a peculiar taste. But she did not drink it. She did not think for a minute that any attempt was being made to poison her, and I do not believe there was, Jordan explained. Journalists couldn't reach Jane to straighten out the details. Before they had a chance, she was dead. Jane's high position and power at the university attracted plenty of attention, and Dr. Jordan's statements and other actions surrounding Jane's death only added to the confusion. Could there have been someone who wanted her dead? Jane didn't grow up with wealth. Before founding Stanford with her husband, Jane grew up in Albany, New York, in the 1820s. The money came when she married Leland, and while finances were never a problem, they struggled with infertility for years. Jane had a son in 1868 when she was 39. The trio lived happily until Leland Jr. caught tuberculosis during a family trip to Europe. A few days before his 16th birthday, Leland Jr. died in an Italian hospital. In the aftermath, Jane and Leland wanted to create something to honor their son. "The children of California shall be our children," Leland said. With that declaration, the pair decided to make Stanford University. The school was originally tuition-free and focused on students who will have nothing but the work out of their hands to sustain them in the future. According to Jane, "I feel that they have not had that encouragement and cheer that they should receive from those who have had superior advantages and larger means," Jane said. In 1891, focusing on these tenets, the college officially opened. Leland wouldn't live to see much of the final product. He died in 1893. Now it was Jane's mission to lead the university and manage the family wealth. Even under this stress, Stanford students adored the founder. The university's board of trustees, on the other hand, disagreed. These administrators and Jane often fought about running the school. In 1903, she gave up her co-founder rights because of the tension. Her life was then pretty quiet until the poisoning incident. Her vacation was going well for her at the Moana Hotel. Jane ate cucumber sandwiches and gingerbread, then drank a laxative and bicarbonate of soda at 8:15 p.m. because she was still full from her lunch. This was when Jane realized she'd been poisoned again. A doctor tried to pump her stomach once he learned what happened, but he couldn't save her. For 3 minutes, Jane convulsed. She exclaimed, "What a horrible death to die," before succumbing to whatever was in her drink at 11:30 p.m. An autopsy confirmed it was again strychnine. Even though a trial ruled that Jane's death was due to strychnine, Dr. Jordan did his best to convince the public A layer of fat around Jane's heart was the actual reason. "I do not care what the people think about what the constables say," David said. "I am firm in my opinion." Others couldn't help but be suspicious. It seems remarkable today that the considered opinions of the attending and autopsy physicians, the toxicologists, the Honolulu Police Department, and the coroner's jury could be so easily dismissed on the basis of a brief declaration by President Jordan. Stanford physician Robert W. P. Cutler wrote in The Mysterious Death of Jane Stanford, "Was the university just trying to protect its image, or was there something more?" In the early 1900s, the perception of Hawaii as an outpost of primitive people that didn't know what they were doing must have factored into Jordan's belief that he could sweep this whole thing under the rug, Robert wrote. And Stanford certainly didn't need another crisis. Before Jane died, the university was already engaged in a few public fights with staff. Robert didn't want to bring more attention to the school and did whatever he could to downplay it. Though he didn't like Jane and wasn't shy about tarnishing her legacy, he probably wasn't the person behind the strychnine. The most likely suspect was Bertha Berner, Jane's personal secretary. Berner was the only person present for both poisonings, which were conducted in the exact same way. When she was questioned about the night of the murder, her story kept changing, and eventually she tried to fit her version into Jordan's outlandish tale. The only odd thing was her motive. Bertha inherited $15,000, about $400,000 today, from Jane. Greed aside, Bertha wasn't married and didn't have children, so working for Jane was her entire life. Maybe there were too many unresolved problems over the years. Or maybe Bertha didn't want to wait for her payday. Well, there was one reason why investigators didn't press the maid too hard. Bertha was fairly old herself. Her advancing age explained her differing and sometimes rambling accounts of the poisonings. And it also cast doubt on her ability to commit murder on her own. Still, some speculation that it was possible she could have administered the strychnine under the direction of Dr. Jordan. To this day, authorities are at a loss about Jane Stanford's killer. The only certainty is that her death was deliberate, and while there may seem hard to believe, even the ivory towers of academia weren't unfamiliar with murder back then. On the other side of the country, another prestigious university dealt with its own gruesome homicide. Please share this story with your friends and family.